Hollywood Babylon by Kenneth Anger. Every man and every woman is a star. Aleister Crowley. To the Scarlet Woman. The Purple Dawn. White elephants. The god of Hollywood wanted white elephants, and white elephants he got. 8 of them. Plaster mammoths perched on mega mushroom pedestals, lording it over the colossal court of Belshazzar. The pasteboard Babylon built beside the dusty tin Lizzie trail called Sunset Boulevard. Griffith, the movie director as God, was riding high as he'd ever go, over Illusion City, wishing up a 100-foot-high elevator camera tower, giant megaphone poised to shout the command to the thousands below. The camera action to bring it all alive. Belshazzar's feast beneath the Egyptian blue skies spread out under the blazing Southern California morning sun. More than 4,000 extras recruited from LA paid an unheard of $2 a day plus box lunch plus car fare to impersonate Assyrian and Median militiamen, Babylon dancers, Ethiopians, East Indians, Numidians, eunuchs, ladies-in-waiting, to the princess beloved, handmaidens of the Babylonian temples, priests of Bel, Nergal, Marduk, and Ishtar, slaves, nobles, and subjects of Babylonia. Griffith's vision of Babylon. A mare's nest mountain of scaffolding, hanging gardens, chariot race ramparts, and sky-high Belshazzar's feast. And sky-high elephants, make-believe mirage of Mesopotamia, drop down the sleepy huddle of mission-style bungalows amid the orange groves that made up 1915 Hollywood, portent of things to come. The purple epoch had begun. And there it stood for years, stranded like some gargantuan dream beside Sunset Boulevard. Long after Griffith's great step into the unknown, his sun play of the ages, intolerance had failed. Long after Belshazzar's court had sprouted weeds, and its walls had begun to peel and warp in abandoned movie set disarray, after the Los Angeles Fire Department had condemned it as a fire hazard, still it stood. Griffith's Babylon, something of a reproach and something of a challenge to the burgeoning movie town, something to surpass, something to live down. The shadow of Babylon had fallen over Hollywood, a serpent spell and code cuneiform. Scandal was waiting, just out of Billy Bitzer's camera range. Hollywood, the movie colony, had been forged into existence by a small group of East Coast Jewish tradesmen who thought they saw a good thing in the Nickelodeon. Lured west by the fabled Southern California promise of 355 days of sunshine a year and low-priced land. The somnolent L.A. outposts in the orange groves they settled on soon sprouted ramshackle open-air stages, sun traps for their slow ortho film. In a few years of churning out primitive and profitable two-reelers, with their pirated cameras always on the lookout for Edison's vengeful process servers. The former junk dealers and glove salesmen juggled a chancy operation into a celluloid bonanza. Ruins of Babylon in 1919. When word reached them that Nickelodeon crowds all over the country seemed to be flocking to see favorite movie performers known only as Little Mary, the Biograph Boy, or the Vitagraph Girl, the disdained actors, until then thought of as little more than hired help, suddenly acquired ticket-selling importance. The already famous faces took on names and rapidly rising salaries. The star system, a decidedly mixed blessing, was born. For better or for worse, Hollywood be henceforth have to contend with that fatal chimera. The star. Fade Barra, first sex queen. Overnight, the obscure and somewhat disreputable movie performers found themselves propelled to adultation, fame, and fortune. They were the new royalty, the golden people. Some managed to cope and took it in their stride, some did not. The teens were Hollywood's Hallison days. A new art form was being forged from day to day. The seventh muse made herself up as she went along, making money and having fun. And if the nouveau riche film folk got tired from the furious pace, there was always joy powder, as cocaine was called in those free and easy days. For a sure thing, pick you up. In fact, a joy powder manic movie comedy style rapidly evolved, the prime example being the triangle keystone cokey comedy, The Mystery of the Leaping Fish, with Doug Fairbanks as a bombed out of his skull detective coke any day. In 1916, dope could be the subject of comedy. The year of that film, The Mystery of the Leaping Fish, English drug expert Aleister Crowley passed through Hollywood, taking note of the natives as the cinema crowd of cocaine-crazed sexual lunatics. Those were the days. Gossip there was, as among any group of show folk, but as yet enshrined in the newspaper column, Luella O'Parsons had yet to set up shop. Behind the scenes, among themselves, the miniature movie colony even dared to gossip about the god of Hollywood, Griffith's obsession on screen. And off. With young female children. And were those Griffith discoveries, those devoted, hardworking child women, really all that virginal? Was it possible? And thinking the unthinkable, was Lillian Gish Dorothy's lover. But it was harmless, really. Even the speculations about Richard Barthelmess posing for French postcards when he was trying to make his way, or the more solid speculations about Max and its famous bathing beauty casting couch, the original model of a long line. If some like to think of Senate Sunshine Girls as a hand-picked harem, why, that didn't bother Big Mac. Theta Barra was always good for a laugh. Hollywood's Babylon. Theta, synthetic sin. The colony knew that the fatal vamp, being sold to the rubes as a French Arab demon of depravity born beneath the Sphinx was in truth Theodosia Goodman, a Jewish tailor's daughter from Chillicothe, Ohio, a meek little goody-two-shoes. In a few more years, America's self-righteous preachers would be maligning the movie colony and all its works. Hollywood, California became a synonym of sin. Professional do-gooders would brand Hollywood a new Babylon, whose evil influence rivaled the legendary depravity of the old. Banner headlines and holier-than-thou editorials would equate sex, dope, and movie stars. Yet while the country's organized crank screamed for blood and boycott, the public unfazed flocked to the movies in ever-increasing multitudes. The 20s is sometimes referred to as Hollywood's golden age, and golden it was. In sheer exuberant movie-making creativity, as well as in financial returns. Film folk of the period are depicted as engaging in madcap, non-stop, off-screen cappers. The legend overlooks one fact, fear. The ever-present, thrilling, erotic fear that the bottom could drop out of their gilded dreams at any time. Scandals exploded like time bombs throughout the delirious decade of wonderful nonsense, as screen career after career was destroyed. Each star wondered if it was his turn to be the next scapegoat. For Hollywood, the fabled golden age was more like a lavish picnic on shaky precipice. The road to glory was beset with booby traps. Yet for the vast public out there, Hollywood was a magical three syllables invoking the wonder world of make-believe. To the faithful, it was more than a dream factory where one young hopeful out of a million got a break. It was dreamland, somewhere else. It was home of the heavenly bodies, the glamour galaxy of Hollywood. Fans worshipped, but the fans could also be fickle, and if their deities proved to have feet of clay, they could be cut down without compassion. Off-screen, a new star was always waiting to make an entrance.